Today I would like to discuss with you, actually, these are only stimulations that I'm going to give you, and then I want to discuss with you this topic, which is a direct access to the unconscious. Expressive movement and dance in the service of psychotherapy. It implies that we have direct access to the unconscious through movement or through expressive movement. So let's see how this is going to happen. Before I start, I remember Freud's words. He said that wherever I go, a poet was there before me. So I choose two small pieces of Nikos Kazantzakis talking about the Greek. The first one says, I was a Russian. I had learned 5 or 6 words of Russian. I got friendly with Russian. He had come to an arrangement as well as we could buy gadgets. He was to speak first. As soon as I couldn't follow him, I was to shout, stop. Then he get up and dance. He danced what he wanted to tell me. And I did the same. Anything we couldn't say with our mouths, we said with our feet, our hands, our belly, or with white eyes. And they didn't speak the same language, but they managed to communicate. How they did it? Through nonverbal communication, through tongues, through expressive, through gestures and postures. And finally, they communicate. This is one of the main elements of dance movement psychotherapy, the use of nonverbal communication. And why this is important? It is important because our first communication in our life is nonverbal. We communicate with our mothers, first year of our life, with words. How we manage, but we communicate. But that's the point. Through nonverbal communication. The second one says, once when my little Dimitri died, I got up and I danced. The relatives and friends who saw me dancing in front of the body rushed up to stop me. So I has gone mad, they cried. But if at that moment I had not danced, I should really have gone mad from grief. Because he was my first son, and he was 3 years old, and I could not bear to lose him. This is the second main element of dance movement psychotherapy. It's the expression through movement, through dance. And it is therapeutically, as a Kazantzakis admitted before the dance movement psychotherapist, that at that point he danced and he didn't get mad. So let's go briefly for a historic review. At the dawn of civilization, dancing, religion, music, and medicine were inseparable. We all know that. The field of dance movement therapy or dance movement psychotherapy has developed by modern dancers who noticed psychological benefits of theirs and others' dance movement practices. They recognize that modern dance positively impacts people's emotional and mental health. So, almost accidentally, from dancers, not from dancers who used to work in psychiatric institutions that noticed these effects of dance. During the 40s, modern dancers began to recognize the emotional and mental therapeutic benefits of creative movement. Without awareness of others doing the same, they initially began to bring movement into the backwards of mental institutions. Since there were no educational institutions teaching this entire movement in the non-therapeutic expression. So that's, that was the beginning. Freud recognized the connection between the body and emotions. He believed that conflict is the responsibility of the ego, which is first and foremost a body ego.
Okay. We talk about body. We talk about body ego. Freud admitted that before the development of our ego, the body ego is developed. Where does it start? Maybe from where you work with premature children. That's why they are touching them, they are giving masses, and they hear music. Even if in that phase, the baby and the mother are separate, are the same. Also Freud spoke about nonverbal communication as well. He said a lot of things. He that has eyes to see and ears to hear may convince himself that no mortal can be ever secret. If the lips are silent, it's others with his fingertips. Betrayal oozes out of him at every pore. And thus the task of making conscious the most hidden recesses of mind is one which it is quite possible to accomplish. Carl Jung as well believed that primitive unconscious material can manifest in artistic experiences, symbolically, and can be evoked through active imagination. Now we are coming to arts as well, how arts start to evolve and use for psychotherapeutic purposes. The American Dance Therapy Association, this is the first dance movement therapy association in the world, was founded in 1966, headed by Myra Chase. The ADTA then began to clarify educational requirements and standardize the definition of dance movement therapy. The second one was the British one, the Association for Dance Movement Psychotherapy, UK, many years, maybe 15 or 20 years after that. Okay. What is the definition of Dance Movement Psychotherapy? Dance Movement Psychotherapy is defined by the Association for Dance Movement Psychotherapy, UK, and the American Dance Therapy Association. Is the psychotherapeutic use of movement and dance through which a person can engage creatively in a process further than emotional, cognitive, physical, and social integration. So the aim is the integration. The integration of what? Of all these parts of the human being. The emotional one, the cognitive one, the physical one, body, movement, and also the social one. Because humans are social beings. There is no human who lives by his own. Even if he lives by his own at the top of the mountain, for example, and says nobody, actually he's not living by his own. Because he carries in him, as we say, internalized objects like his mother, his father, his friends, whatever. Or the cat. He's doing the best. But again, he's not by his own. Okay, that's why therapy utilizes knowledge, theories, and methods of many different areas, such as psychology, developmental psychology, neuropsychology, psychiatrics, individual and group psychotherapy, psychoanalysis, group dynamics, nonverbal communication, and movement analysis. So now I have to say that in order to be
become a transformer therapist. This is a postgraduate study, it's a master's degree as program, as music therapy. And this is the reason, because you need the first degree, you need the basic knowledge, and then you expand your knowledge in all these subjects. Industrial therapy movement is used to facilitate change within individuals and in their ability to relate to others. Because we can have individual sessions, we can have group sessions, as well as family sessions and couple. DMT works with many different client situations. For example, individuals who want to increase their self-awareness and feel comfortable with movement and dance, adults and children with mental or physical disabilities, learning difficulties, families and couples who want to improve their relationship or find solutions to their dysfunctions. In addition, DMT is extremely beneficial to those patients who lack the ability to communicate verbally, as well as for those clients who have an excellent ability to use language, but they use it in a defensive, rational way, which does not allow them to get in contact with their deeper self. You work with a client that he's so repressed that he doesn't speak. How can you do verbal psychotherapy? You can't. You need other ways. Arts. One of these is expressive movement, or music, or painting, or drama. As we saw the Anastasia before, on the wheelchair, she was completely non-verbal, but she communicated perfectly through movement. But also, it's interesting, what happened with people who are, let's say, extremely verbal and have great ability in using their words. For example, solicitors or lawyers or philosophers, maybe. They give hard time to their psychotherapists. The verbal sectors. Very hard time. But in movement expression, no. We as that movement therapist have another problem. What if a performer, dancer, come to us for transplant? Then we have a problem. We refer him to a verbal secretary. Not always. Five fundamental theoretical assumptions about transformer therapy. There is a continuous interaction between body and mind, and when an important change is realized on the movement level, it can influence the mental or emotional one, and vice versa. Therapist connects the movement experiences with verbal understanding by means of free association and interpretations of movement. So, for example, think somebody has a car accident and he loses his legs and stays for the rest of his life on a wheelchair. Do you think that? Is he going to have any change in his mind or emotional state or whatever? Probably. Definitely. Not probably. The other way around. Think that one day, for a reason or maybe for no reason, you feel sad. Is this the same way that you walk or you move than another day that you are happy? Second, facets of the individual's personality are reflected on movement. These facets can include ways, patterns of social correlation, psychological developmental processes, psychopathology, etc. For example, if you observe, let's say, a psychotic person who is in crisis, do you think that are you going to realize something maybe strange in his movement, or he is moving exactly like us? What do you think? Yeah, you can say it from just observing him. You don't have to ask him how he feels. It's obvious. Or maybe someone who is obsessive compulsive disorder, for example. The therapeutic relationship between patient and therapist is of utmost importance. The therapist uses mainly nonverbal response and interaction towards the patient, such as movement mirroring, synchronization, physical contact, and so on. We had a nice panel yesterday about this therapeutic relationship. Actually, what we call therapeutic relationship is the relationship between the therapist and the client or the patient. And this relationship is a unique one. This relationship, it's not like any other one. It's not a professional relationship, it's not a friendly relationship, it's not an erotic or sexual relationship. It's a unique one. I will give time at the end to ask me if you want things about this. Movement can be an indicator of an unconscious process. I'm not saying anything more about this now because I will speak more about that later. And involvement in a creative movement process through improvisation has great therapeutic value. By exploring new ways of body movement, the individual acquires new experiences. We are all artists or are therapists, so we know very well the therapeutic value of improvisation. Also before we saw some improvisation with this child with the Down syndrome playing the guitar and the piano. Let's move on now to the definition of the unconscious. What is the unconscious? In Freud's psychoanalytic theory of personality, the unconscious mind is a reservoir of feelings, desires, memories, instincts, conflicts, drives that is outside of our conscious awareness. Most of the contents of the unconscious are unsettled or unpleasant, such as feelings of pain, anxiety, or conflict, so they are repressed. According to Freud, the unconscious continues to influence our behavior and experiences, even though we are unaware of these underlying influences. And this is a nice figure of the two classifications of Freud, the local and the structural. It's like an iceberg, as we can see. Conscious is up there, the sky with the sun. We all know this. Pre-conscious, between conscious and unconscious, pre-conscious and unconscious contains repressed elements, but from the pre-conscious we can easily recall them, but not from the unconscious. As you can see, it is completely unconscious. But superego and ego are partially unconscious and partially conscious. Ego actually is between the superego and the id. Ego is the structure of the psychic apparatus that communicate with the outer world. So it's okay, so the defense mechanisms. Is that is between the drives from the id that comes from the bottom of the cell and the superego. Superego is like, let's say, the internal policeman who says what we must do or we must not do. And ego tries to be between. Now, play, transitional space, and therapeutic change. Freud described in 1908 the play as an integral part of human activity. He associated play with the function of creativity, whereby the child, while playing, becomes the creator of his world and reacts indirectly the pleasures and conflicts of his unconscious life. Other psychoanalysts came to clarify more about the play. The important function of play has been recognized by several writers. Winnicott's contribution is quite significant. He writes, play is widespread and belongs to health. Play facilitates development and consequently health. Play leads to group relationships. It can become a form of communication in psychotherapy. And with ethnic psychoanalysis has been developed as a high specialized form of play in the service of the individual's communication with the others. Actually, what Winnicott says is that during a therapeutic session, we play with our client. And why we play, we will see. Also Freud, in Art and Psychoanalysis, said that the poet acts like a child plays. He creates a fantastic world, and he takes it seriously. In other words, he invests it with libido, but at the same time, he clearly distinguishes it from the reality. This is what children do when they play. And also, not only poets, but I think all artists are doing this. So, according to Winnicott, play is the creation of an intermediate area of experience between subjectivity and objectivity. Both play and creativity derive from the transitional phenomena which happens within a transitional space, namely in the intermediate area between the thumb and the teddy bear, between the oral erotism and the two objective relationships, between primary creative activity and projection of what has already been interjected, between inner and outside world, between mother and child. It is an area of experience which is overlapped by both deities and where they both meet. So when the child starts to differentiate, to go into the separation individuation phase, and he starts to understand that he's different from his mother, uses some objects, also his thumb, or some teddy bears, or bushels, or whatever, as a representation of the mother figure. So when the mother is not there, the object is there, and relaxes or pacifies him for a certain time, until the mother becomes the child knows that when he plays, this is not just fantasy. He knows that it's something between fantasy and reality. That's the point. this space, the transitional space, where fantasy and reality partially coexist, is the main space of human experience and remains during the entire lifespan. In the sphere of the most intense experiences, such as the ones pertaining to arts, religious practice, living with creative imagination, and creative scientific work. So we become artists, or we become science, both of this experience we had when we were infants and children. We know how to do it. We have been playing a lot, and then when we become adults, we play, but we play in a different way. We play through arts. Actually, we use this word. We say, I play the guitar, I play the piano. Play theater, or I'm going to watch a nice play. We would believe that psychotherapy takes place within the boundaries of a region where the two areas of play, the two transitional spaces, the patients and the therapists overlap. Patients' transitional space. Therapist transitional space, there is a common space there. Common transitional space where therapeutic change takes place. Therapeutic change takes place only in this common transitional space. If I can make this complicated. Okay? If the therapist cannot play, then he is not appropriate for the job. If the patient cannot play, then something must be done so that he can acquire the ability to play, and only afterwards can psychotherapy begins. The reason why playing is essential and substantial in therapy is because the patient is creating only there. Fortunately, we as arts therapists, we know to play, so we don't have so much problem with this. But this is not for art therapists, it's for all psychotherapists. Winko says here, if a psychotherapist cannot play, he's not good for the job. So, based on direct access to the unconscious dreams, sleep of the tongue, drawings, squiggles, free associations. Movement can be evidence of unconscious material. Central important are the movement symbols, images, and metaphors that are articulated by the client patient during the session. The process of symbolizing is completely unconscious, and only what is repressed is symbolized or need to be symbolized. The notion of transitional space offers an excellent description of the environment created during a therapy session through creative arts therapies. It is a space where the means of the art is used creatively and expressively. It is a space of metaphoric and symbolic imagery where the internal, the external, the self, and the other join. Within this transitional space, the patient interacts with the therapist and with one another, in case of group therapy, and the transverse relationship develops. The children are provided with the opportunity to express themselves through their natural expressive way, which is the play. And the physical movement is one trait of playing the conscious and unconscious fantasies and desires. In the first year of a child's life, play is primarily a body expression, but while the child moves on to the Oedipal phase, it starts playing on a symbolic way.